Let me start right out by saying this episode is a disaster.
It's a complete disaster.
It's multiple disasters.
Epic multiple disasters.
This is the Horror Guys, and I'm Brian.
And I'm Kevin.
And we've got four movies and a short for you this week, as always. We're stretching the boundaries of horror a little bit to talk about phobias and nightmares.
Things to be afraid of.
And the 1970s was a very dangerous time to be alive.
It was. Boy, stuff happening left and right.
Yeah, this week we've got the original airplane disaster movie, 1970s Airport. Ooh, scary stuff. Not so much, but it had a whole bunch of sequels.
It was tense and, you know, it was suspenseful.
How many people are afraid to fly?
Some.
Lots.
Some, yeah.
Then we've got the Poseidon Adventure from 2 years later in 1972.
Because what happens on a cruise when the boat flips upside down? Ooh, that's bad.
That's bad.
That's bad.
And that happens a lot, doesn't it?
It has happened.
It's not common.
They have flipped, but no, it's not common.
A bit more common are earthquakes. And we've got Earthquake from 1974, where we get to watch Los Angeles fall to pieces.
We got a big one here.
And the Towering Inferno from 1974. How many people are still afraid to go into skyscrapers today?
Mm-hmm.
You go up in one of those things, you look out the window, and you feel the whole building swaying.
You feel it sway. You look at your GPS, and it's swaying.
All right, and as a bonus, if you sign up over at horrorbulletin.com for our newsletter, we also talk about Airport 75, the first of several sequels to the original Airport movie. That's the one where two airplanes collide in midair. And also Meteor from 1979, where Sean Connery fights off an attack from space. Okay, it's not really an attack from space.
It's a big rock.
But it's got Russians, so it's scary.
It's one of the asteroids.
Yeah.
Comes to Earth for a visit.
4 years ago this week, on episode number 9, we looked at two very strange movies. We looked at 1985's The Stuff.
That was a good one. That's kind of a classic, I think.
Yeah. Oh. You were way more impressed with The Stuff than I was.
I was, yeah.
It's cheap, it's cheesy, and it is low-budget schlock.
It's so fun, yes.
And 2019's Crucible of the Vampire, which I vaguely remember liking, but I couldn't really tell you what it's about today.
You know, I think I would completely have to look up what that was about if I, you know, I did look up what it was about.
There's a vampire and a metal pot that's buried in a basement somewhere.
Yeah, it wasn't that memorable.
No.
It was pleasant, but yeah, forgettable.
It's amazing how only 4 years ago, and we've kind of forgotten the plots of some of these less than stellar movies.
And yet, 40 years later, The Stuff is still fresh in my mind.
Well, you got stuff like Nosferatu that's like almost, well, I think it's 100 years old this year.
Some things are classic, yeah. And some things are not.
All right, well, we have two major announcements pertaining to our books. The Horror Guy's Guide to the Halloween Films is available now at our web store, and it is 100% free if you're listening.
Free?
You go to the store, it says it's $1.99, because we priced it cheap, because it is a short one. There's only 13 movies.
But there's a loophole.
If you use the coupon code Halloween, it's free. No strings, no attachments, no sign-ups for anything. You got to put in your name and an email so it can send you the information for downloading, but you're not going on any list. There's absolutely no catch, no trick. It's just a free book. We want you to have a free Horror Guys book so you can see what they're all about, and then maybe you'll buy all the others. Honest marketing.
Like a dealer, you know, you give them a little taste first.
Exactly.
Get them hooked, yes. And then they come back and buy.
Yeah, even if you're not interested in the Halloween movies, and a lot of people aren't, pick this up, look through it, and you'll get an idea what the Horror Guys guides are all about.
Uh-huh.
And also, if you're not interested in the free ebook, all our paperbacks are at 15% off if you pick them up through Lulu this month.
Because we like you.
Go to Lulu, buy our books, or honestly, any book they've got, and use the promo code February15, February15, to get 15% off everything in your order.
Okay.
Stock them up. Buy them all.
Buy them all. Yeah.
Yeah. And of course, if you go to thehorrorguysshop.com or brianshell.com, my name, you will find links to all these books, the paperbacks, the ebooks, and everything else there. All right. Any major announcements from you that we didn't cover?
No major announcements.
All right. So this week we are looking at Well, they're not natural disasters. What do you call these?
Well, some are natural. The meteor's an asteroid.
What is our theme this week?
That's a bonus one.
Airport is not a natural disaster.
No.
Large-scale disasters.
Large-scale disasters, I guess, is the way you'd put it.
Yes, and next week we're going to be looking at small-scale disasters with stupid people versus nature.
bad things happening to many people all at once.
Yeah, we got 2 weeks worth of disaster. They're not all the same. This week is the big-budget disaster movies. Next week we've got
the small, intimate. Sometimes people are making bad choices that leads to a disaster.
Realistically, you know, all of them are people making bad choices.
Well, not these big ones. Not always.
Oh, yeah. And next week.
Yeah. Yeah. Brought on by their own choices.
Bad things happen to good people this week. Bad things happen to dumb people next week.
Yeah, somewhat.
But we'll start out this week with 1970's Airport, directed by George Seaton and Henry Hathaway, written by Arthur Haley, the guy who did Roots. So, yeah, all right, he did an airport. I think it was called Airport.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, George Seaton stars Burt Lancaster, Dean Martin, Gene Seberg, Jacqueline Bisset, and George Kennedy. 2 hours and 17 minutes.
And this movie and all these movies this week are like, you know, every actor in the 70s in these movies. They're just a huge cast of people, big, big names.
Before there was The Love Boat, before there was Murder, She Wrote, there was disaster movies. Yeah, these are all giant, long movies. This first one's 2 hours and 17 minutes.
They're epic.
I think The Towering Inferno is close to 3 hours. These are big, epic movies with huge casts. If you look at just the poster, the movie poster for Airport, there's no airplane. It's 12 recognizable stars with big names is the poster.
Mm-hmm.
Like, forget there's a plot. Come see these people. Spoiler free for anybody who hasn't watched this in 53 years. What happens?
Fear of flying caused by a movie. Now, that's a phobia, which is horror. Right? Maybe.
I like how every post this week you wrote the spoiler free. You're making apologies that it's not really horror.
By genre definition.
I doubt they're considered horror movies, but they scared a lot of people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and horrible things happen to a lot of people in these movies. Yeah, this is a good movie, though. It takes its time and builds tension, really well directed and well written. There's the disaster and the aftermath. It's realistic and big budget and a large cast of familiar faces.
And I think that's the point of these movies at the time, is to watch the familiar faces.
Mm-hmm. That was a big draw.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this one also has the lowest body count. What's that, one or maybe two?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's tiny. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Well, credits roll over scenes of snowplows and flamethrowers cleaning up the runways at an airport. It's a busy day at Lincoln International Airport. Did we decide this was a real place?
Yes. Yes, it is.
We watch an airplane land in the snow, and from the music we can tell that it's very tense. They land short and run halfway off the runway. Emergency vehicles are dispatched, and traffic is rerouted to other runways. Mel Bakersfield is called in to deal with a situation on the ground. Tanya calls to ask him for coffee, but he has to deal with that plane first.
Did you mean, like, literally a real, like, Lincoln? It was at a real airport.
Like Lincoln, Nebraska or
something. Oh, Lincoln International Airport is not a... No, they made up the name.
It's not a real place.
No, okay. They filmed it at a real airport.
Though. Well, yeah.
I thought that's what you meant. No.
This isn't happening at a real live airport.
It's a fictitious take on a real airport.
Okay. Well, Tanya wants to ride with Mel to the field. Meanwhile, his Karen-esque wife calls... Is it Karen-esque or is she just a Karen?
I think she's just a Karen.
Yeah, this was like 50 years ago, so they didn't have that term back then. Angry that he's made yet another excuse not to be there for dinner. Because, you know, crashed airplanes are not as important as being there for dinner.
Dinner. Well, I guess it happens a lot, and he's more than full-time on the job.
Yeah.
She's tired of it.
Mel calls in Joe Petroni, an expert on plane maintenance, who's busy tonight but comes in anyway. And Joe Petroni, I think, George Kennedy ends up showing up in all these airport movies. He kind of made a career out of disaster movies.
Yeah, he did.
Mel is the airport's general manager, and he's got lots of problems. There's a bunch of protesters holding signs to close down Runway 22. And we get a little scene about how these people are sitting down to dinner, and this airplane flies over, and the glass in the china cabinet rattles, and they all crawl under the table. It's loud. Yeah, I'd be complaining, too.
And people are complaining.
Vernon and Sarah Demarest arrive. She's Mel's sister, and Vernon recently sent in a bad report about the airport's snowy runway, which annoys Mel. Vernon is a pilot, and he seems to be a kind of a prima donna. This is Dean Martin, and he's playing Burt Lancaster's brother-in-law, the arrogant pilot.
And a sober guy.
I think a lot of that was just an act. I don't think Dean Martin was the drunk he pretended to be.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was a character, I think, that he adopted, you know, as a character of himself. And he was a drunk in a lot of movies.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not in this one, though.
Well, we see Vernon get into a cab and go to his stewardess and secret girlfriend Gwen's house. Mel and his wife Cindy argue on the phone again. She wants him to take a regular job in her father's company. Vernon comes back to the snowed-in airplane and says that he refuses to take off on Runway 22. Now, you see, we see why the locals don't like Runway 22, because it's too low and close to the ground.
The pilots don't like it either.
We don't know why exactly. It's just a short runway, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Well, a stowaway, Mrs. Ada Quonset, is brought into Tanya. She's an old woman who does this all the time. She couldn't possibly afford a ticket. Mel comes in and talks to the old woman, who knows they won't do anything to a little old lady. She details all the different ways of sneaking onto a plane, and she's quite a con artist. Yeah, she's got a whole string of little tricks that...
And yeah, she's good at
it. Airport security back then wasn't what it was today.
Yeah, it's a little tighter now.
Well, they're going to send her back to Los Angeles on the next flight. Tanya is annoyed with the old woman, but Mel is simply amused. He runs the airport. He doesn't care about the money.
Yeah.
Afterward, Mel and Tanya talk about themselves, and Tanya gets called to customs where a woman has been caught smuggling items into the country. Ah, the fun of working at an airport.
Uh-huh.
A man in a rundown apartment, Don Guerrero, checks the flight to Rome will depart on time. He packs his passport and starts assembling a bomb.
Uh-oh.
He stops in the diner downstairs and tells his wife that he's starting a new job and things will be good again. She tells him to stop dreaming, but he says, "I'll do it right this time." He then gets on the bus to the airport. Meanwhile, Vernon talks to Anson Harris, his co-pilot before the flight to Rome. Joe Petroni arrives and takes over moving that airplane off the runway that's in the way. Mel hears that the locals are going to sue him over Runway 22, which is too close. Inez Guerrero, the other guy's wife, goes home to find a letter from the travel company that they overcharged her husband for his ticket to Rome. He wasn't going to Rome. He was going somewhere else.
Yeah, not what he said. Yeah.
That's not what he told her.
And I could just throw in now, because I don't think we mentioned it, this is actually inspired by true events.
This part, yeah.
There was a guy that did that with a bomb and tried to collect on travel insurance and successfully blew himself up, blew a hole in the side of the plane. And nothing else happened. The plane landed okay. And then afterward they said, "No, we're not going to pay that insurance."
Well, if the whole plane goes down and everybody dies, it's a mystery. You might get away with it. But everybody knew that guy did it.
Yeah. Yeah, they did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, she calls the airport to see if he's on the flight, and they tell her she has to come in person. I don't know. They got HIPAA or something back then.
Yeah.
Gwen tells Vernon that she's pregnant with his child. She knows he's married and can't marry her. She offers to get an abortion, but she's not sure if that's a good idea. She thinks she might want to keep it, maybe for adoption.
And this was a controversial issue at the time.
We didn't catch on to that until almost a week after we watched it.
Reading about it later.
This was 1970. They didn't have abortions back then. Not legally.
Not legally like now. And yeah, this was pre-Roe versus Wade. And yeah, that was a bigger deal.
Of course, these guys...
Even more controversial then than today, probably.
All worked for an airline. I'm sure that there were countries where they could get it done.
Mm-hmm.
USA, not so much, but other places, sure.
Harder, too. Yeah.
Mr. Guerrero buys a bunch of flight insurance that pays out if anything bad happens to the flight. And he's got a bomb in his carry-on briefcase. Meanwhile, his wife arrives outside the airport. Harry, the old experienced security guard, notices that Guerrero is acting suspiciously. Uh-oh. He's like TSA before there was TSA.
Mm-hmm. Like a store detective.
Basically that, yeah. More like a store detective than anything else.
Plain clothes hanging out, yeah.
Mrs. Quonset hears that there's a plane going to Rome, and she fakes having a seizure, which gives her the opportunity to give her guard the slip and board that plane. She's a sneaky old fart.
Yeah, she is.
She sits down right next to Mr. Guerrero. Captain Vernon is informed that the head count isn't quite right. There's an extra person, but he's in a hurry because of the weather and insists on taking off right now. Mrs. Guerrero runs to the boarding ramp, but she's too late. She suspects what her husband is up to. Well, Tanya figures out where Mrs. Quonset went and calls the plane. Gwen goes back to see if the old woman is there, which she is. They decide not to do anything about it until they land. Why make a scene?
Yeah.
Vernon and Anson talk about abortions and unplanned children. A definite no-no topic back then.
Mm-hmm.
Mrs. Guerrero is really upset, and someone brings her to Tanya, who recognizes the name of the very last man who got on the flight. He was acting all sketchy at the time, and they noticed him.
Yeah, acting nervous.
Cindy shows up and tells Mel that she wants a divorce and that her daughter has run away. We never hear anything else about the daughter, do we?
No, I don't think so. No.
I mean, just piling it on.
Yeah.
Tanya tells Mel about Guerrero, and they figure out his plan. Suicide by bomb for the insurance money. His wife says that he used to work with explosives in his old job before he went to the mental hospital.
Oh, yeah, my. This is great. Yeah.
Well, they call Vernon aboard the plane about the potential bomber. Mel calls Petroni inside to talk about structural stuff if the bomb should go off. He explains that it'll blow a hole in the plane, which will suck out everything within 20 feet of the bomb. The plane might still be able to fly. Anson decides to turn the plane around and head back where they came from, while Vernon goes back to the passenger compartment to see what's up. Mel's boss comes in and wants to shut down the airport, which is really bad timing.
Yeah, and it's smooth how he does that, Vernon. He's walking down the aisle and, you know, hi, you know, welcome to the flight. Everybody doing okay? And, you know, just a meet and greet down the aisle as the captain, you know, talking to everybody and casually, you know, looks at the guy with the bomb and the case that he's holding and, you know, assessing the information. I thought he was very smooth about
scoping people out. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, Gwen confronts Mrs. Quonset about her missing ticket. They bring her to the pilot's cabin. It's really just a ploy. Vernon doesn't care about her being a stowaway. He wants her to go back to her seat and help with Mr. Guerrero.
Yeah, right next to the bomb.
The old lady works a distraction, and Gwen grabs the suitcase with a bomb. Guerrero grabs it back and heads to the back of the plane. Vernon tells him that everyone knows what's going on, and his insurance won't pay out. Which is basically what you said about the true side of the story.
Yeah, yeah.
Vernon talks Guerrero into giving up the bomb, but then some random guy comes out of the restroom behind him, and Guerrero ducks inside, panics, and the bomb goes off. Boom. Since it was in the restroom, the damage is less severe than they expected. Vernon returns to the cabin and sends a second officer back to clean up the mess, and the second officer notices a big crack in the roof and reports back to Vernon.
Yeah, and there is a hole in the plane.
Oh, yeah.
Some air did get sucked out and stuff. But
it's in the restroom, so they close the door and it doesn't decompress quite so badly.
Yeah, it does help it, yeah.
The air controller calls Vernon. They may have to land on the too short runway 22, which annoys everyone. Extra stress. It's up to Mel and Joe Petroni to get that other runway clear. Remember that plane that ran off the runway at the very beginning?
It's still in the way.
Joe swears he can drive the stuck plane off the runway, but he needs 15 more minutes. There is drama and angst as Joe pushes the engines to the limit before the bulldozers can wreck his plane. Joe gives it all she's got, and the plane finally gets off the runway, freeing things up for Vernon's flight.
Yay!
The concern now is the crack in the plane. One bounce and we'll leave the tail behind. It's cloudy, so they have to go in blind on their landing path. Could this get any more tense? A priest smacks a whiny passenger for panic. He's like, oh, we're going to die, and the priest punches him.
Yeah.
It's tense, but they land safely and intact. Vernon runs back to talk to Gwen, who might lose an eye or her baby. She was the only person really wounded in the explosion.
Mm-hmm.
He tells her that they're going to be fine. The news people are all over the airport by the time the passengers disembark. Mrs. Guerrero rushes in to apologize to the passengers for what her husband did. Sarah, Vernon's wife, overhears that Gwen is pregnant and knows that her marriage is over too.
Mm-hmm.
Mrs. Quonset is given a legitimate plane ticket for her help. Mel and Tanya then go out for breakfast.
Happy ending.
After all that, Waffle House.
And it was interesting. It had been so long since I'd seen this, but I've seen Airplane, the spoof.
Oh, yes.
A couple times, maybe probably three times, yeah. And it was funny seeing all these things that they got, you know, that they're spoofing Airplane.
Well, the entire plot and most of the jokes actually are based on stuff that happens here.
Yeah, most of it, yeah. Uh-huh.
Well, quite a few interesting split-screen shots that sort of resemble comic book layouts, which show things like both sides of a phone conversation made it a little bit interesting. You could see two people were talking, and then suddenly three people were talking, and you'd see them all on screen at once.
Yeah, the clever direction really livened things up.
You used to see that kind of thing a lot in the past, and you don't see that so much anymore.
No,
multiple
not really.
Sides of a phone call. There are many elaborate sets and a huge cast of characters that were all fairly recognizable at the time. Young people today say, look at all these old dead people, but they were all familiar faces in the 70s.
Yeah, they were.
It's very long. The plane doesn't even take off until 70 minutes in. And the film actually still mostly holds up. Obviously, airport security is way, way more secure now than what's shown here. But it was pretty accurate for the time period. Overall, I thought we both liked it. It was well acted. The efforts are good for the time period. And it's actually tense where it needs to be. There are some bits of humor here and there to keep it going. Only one person dies, so there are actually more divorces in the film than there were fatalities.
Yeah, that's true.
Mel's getting a divorce. Vernon's getting a divorce. It's only a minor disaster, but the film and its sequels caused phobias for generations. Overall, it's 53 years old and still a thumbs up from me.
Me too.
Yeah, it's a good one. And next up, we have another disaster.
The Poseidon Adventure.
Airplane was a big success in 1970, so they decided, hey, let's try this disaster thing again. So yeah, The Poseidon Adventure, directed by Ronald Neim, written by Paul Gallico, Sterling Siliphant, who was involved with, I think, almost all of these, Wendell Mays, stars Gene Hackman, Ernest Borgnine, Shelley Winters, Red Buttons.
And a whole lot of other people.
And we were just thinking before we started recording this, I think Gene Hackman's the only one who's still alive, other than maybe the kids.
The only other, the main players, yeah.
Hour and 57 minutes, trailer in the show notes. And again, this movie poster. You see the boats upside down, people are hanging from the tables, water's rushing in, and you can recognize the cast there at the bottom.
That really is quite a poster.
It is. Yeah. It looks action-packed.
Yeah, it does.
And this movie has got a lot more action than the previous one did.
It does, yeah.
Yeah, the other one is people on an airplane
for
the
most part.
Oh, yeah, almost everybody.
A lot of them, yeah.
Spoiler-free. It's an epic disaster adventure with a big cast of powerhouse actors that is still very entertaining 50 years later. Again, Kevin says it's not quite in the horror genre, but there's plenty of people being trapped, drowned, blown up, falling and burned in a large ship that is completely flipped, so there's lots of fear and tension.
Mm-hmm. I think more so than airplane.
I think this definitely qualifies as horror more than airplane did.
Yeah.
Airport, not airplane.
Yeah, there's a lot more horrifying moments.
There's some gore and people burning and Well, what happens?
We're told it's New Year's Eve and the ship Poseidon went down with only a handful of survivors.
Spoilers.
Yeah, they tell you up front.
Yeah.
Captain Harrison calls the engine room.
Leslie Nielsen.
Oh, yeah.
In a completely serious role.
In a serious role.
Well, he played mostly serious people until like the 80s.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was just a generic actor basically at the time.
Mm-hmm. But that's not good enough. The engineer says the company man, Linarkos, is the problem, not the stabilizers. The waves are high and it's getting rough. The ship leans quite dramatically, and the captain says they're top-heavy.
As far as this one scene that we're talking about, the ship leans way over. It's like 90 degrees, 45 degrees. Everything in the place would be tipping over.
Yeah, but
and
the
passengers
don't really notice. So I think there's a little bit of disconnect there.
Yeah, it looks a lot worse to the captain than it could have possibly been.
Yeah. Well, the ship's doctor and nurse go to see Mr. and Mrs. Rogo. She's very seasick, and he's kind of a loudmouth jerk. He doesn't know what to do with the suppositories they give to his wife.
She can't keep her food down. What's she supposed to do with these suppositories?
Yeah. Well, meanwhile, James Martin is a fitness nut, out jogging on the deck, right past Mr. and Mrs. Rosen, who are headed to Israel to meet their grandson. So we're introducing all the characters right off the bat. Reverend Scott argues with the ship's chaplain. He no longer believes praying works. He self-describes himself as a angry, rebellious, clinical, a renegade. And he believes in taking control of your own destiny and not relying on God to help you out.
Well, that's just a great preacher there.
Yeah.
It's not the way that's supposed to go, is it?
Well, Linarkos orders the captain to go full speed. But the captain says they don't have enough ballast. And this is the final voyage of the old ship, which is due to be scrapped. Lindercross insists, and the captain does as he's told. Well, in the ballroom, there's a big party. Nanny Perry rehearses her song the morning after.
Which was a big hit, and I think maybe the number one song of the year because of the movie.
Yeah, yeah. Mr. Akers, one of the waiters, likes her music. Little Robin annoys his older sister, Susan, with all the details and facts about the ship. He knows everything about the boat.
He doesn't just annoy Susan. He annoys everyone,
but
us included.
But that'll come in later, having him all that ship knowledge. Rogo and his wife argue about her former profession. She used to be a hooker, and she's always afraid of being recognized. Rogo is a cop, and he arrested her 6 times before he married her.
Can you imagine that situation in real life?
I can, yeah. Well, it's the big New Year's Eve dinner. Mrs. Rosen asks James Martin why he isn't married. He's just too busy and a confirmed bachelor.
It never really comes up,
mm-hmm.
but you figure he was gay?
No, I think he was sweet on the one gal, wasn't he?
She was half his age. I think he was just being parental.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I think if this were done today, he would be very, very gay instead of just being a confirmed bachelor.
Mm-hmm. That was, I think, the implication.
Yeah, he's not married, and everybody think that's strange. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think that was the implication.
Yeah.
But it's early 70s, so that's all we get.
Mm-hmm. The first mate gets a report of a subsea earthquake not too far away, but the captain is at dinner. They call him, he comes to the bridge, and is told that the approaching tidal wave is mountainous.
Look at those mountains off in the distance.
That's not a mountain, that's a wave. Midnight comes, and everyone's celebrating the new year. The enormous wall of water hits them. And it's unfortunate timing, because it's like right at midnight, and there's this raucous cacophony
Three,
of
two,
noise.
One!
And they're all shouting and music playing and everything, and the ship's, you know, alarm, the klaxon is going off. They, oh, it's just part of the party noise.
Yeah.
Well, so they aren't braced at anything. The whole ship rolls over. The captain, crew, they're all killed immediately. People roll, fall, and scream as the huge ballroom slowly turns upside down. People hang from the tables that are bolted to the now ceiling, some of them falling one by one. Well, Reverend Scott, once things settle down a little bit, immediately sets about helping the injured while the various other characters come to grips with what just happened. Susan is stuck way up high on one of those tables. Scott gets many of the characters to stretch a tablecloth so she can jump down and land on that. Martin suggests to Scott that any rescue is going to come through the bottom of the boat, which is now the top, so they all need to climb up. And it's an interesting set because everything is upside down now, and they literally are climbing
up. They're standing on the roof.
Yeah,
they want to climb up to the floor.
Yeah, yeah. So it's interesting how they did that. They all work together to move a Christmas tree so they can climb it to get to the galley. And some climb up, one by one. The purser disagrees with the plan and insists in staying at the ballroom to stay for help. Many agree with him. Scott asks the old chaplain to go along, but he wants to stay with the dying and the wounded. And there's some arguing with the others. Scott gives up climbing the tree himself. So there's a
lot of debate.
Yeah, but a group have, you know, gone up to a safe platform and the rest are down. Well, when there's suddenly an explosion, the ship starts rocking again. The ballroom erupts in fire and water, and now there's a mad stampede to the Christmas tree, which gets overloaded and collapses. And Scott closes the door on the screaming people. It's time to move on.
And now we're down to a cast of about 8.
Yeah, yeah. Rogo and Scott argue about who's in charge, but Scott gets his way. They all have to walk through a burning kitchen full of bodies, and the water starts pouring in behind them. So they're on a quest for, you know, this path, but they're kind of time-limited, too. Yeah, the water's coming in after them. Well, they must climb a ladder in a huge vertical shaft, and there's another explosion, and Akers and Rogo fall off the ladder. Rogo looks for Akers, but can't find him. And they encounter a bunch of other survivors who are following the doctor forward toward the bow of the ship. But Scott says they're going the wrong way, but they don't listen.
You see, the rear of the bow of the ship is the thin part where the engines and the propeller are. The front is the thickest part, which would be like reinforced in case they hit an iceberg or something. It'd be much harder to cut through.
Yeah, so they're thinking that if once the rescuers get there, that's where they're going to cut through the bottom of the ship. Well, they argue some more about which way to go. Scott goes ahead to scout a path to the engine room, leaving the others behind so they can have some dramatic character-defining moments.
Talking time.
Lots of that, yeah. Well, they come to a place that is only recently flooded, and Scott says they can just swim the short distance to the other side. Mrs. Rosen says she used to be a swimming champion, and this is something she can do.
And throughout the entire movie, she's been complaining about how big and fat she is. She can't fit through the doors, she can't fit through the tunnels, she can't walk, and she's not that bad. She does all these things.
Yeah.
But she consistently points out how overweight she is.
Well, now she wants to be the swimming hero. And Scott thanks her, but he goes to the other side first. But he runs into trouble. She goes in and rescues him, saves his life, but she has a heart attack and dies on the other side.
Oops.
Yeah. And that's a heartbreaker, too, because and they don't tell Mr. Rosen right away because they don't want him to fall to pieces on that side, and they want him to make it through. So
I think she won an award for this, Academy Award or something, possibly.
Nominated, I think.
Nominated, okay.
Yeah, yeah. Well, they go across a narrow catwalk that goes to the propeller shaft, and that's where the thinnest part of the hull is. Anyone trying to rescue them will come in that way, they think. There's another explosion, and Mrs. Rago falls to her death. And Ernest Borgnine takes that poorly. Rago, Borgnine, turns on Scott, blaming him for everything. But Mr. Rosen clears that up.
Hey, my wife died too. You shut the hell up.
Yep, yep. Get some calm down. Yeah. Hot steam starts spraying the exit door so they can't get out. So the only thing to do is turn the relief valve. But in order to do that, Scott has to jump on the valve. And he does turn it off, but then he falls to his death, sacrificing himself for all the others. With the steam shut down, everyone heads to the exit. Martin, Nani, Susan, Robin, Mr. Rosen, and Rago are soon rescued by men in helicopters who have cut through the hull.
Yay!
Yay!
And the one single helicopter flies off, and I guess they just leave the rest for everybody to die.
Oh, they'll be back for more. They were going to show, there was a planned shot showing a bunch of rescue boats and vehicles around the submerged ship, but they ran out of budget. So they actually, this helicopter landed in a parking lot for real. And, the people, got on it, and they just didn't show anything else.
Wow.
It was a trick shot, real helicopter, real people. But yeah, they, because of budget reasons, So the implication is there's other rescue boats there. And they actually came up, they did a sequel to this.
Yes, they did.
And there were more groups surviving in the boat that we didn't see.
Yeah.
There's a team of people that go back in the boat and, they have adventures in the sequel. But anyway, that's it for this movie.
Even before the accident, the camera was regularly tilting during the scenes to make us think that the boat was rocking gently. If you watch when the singer is doing her scenes, you can see that the camera is just slowly panning right and left, just a little bit, but you can definitely feel the rocking as you watch.
Except,
we noticed the drinks on the table weren't moving.
Yeah, the liquid was perfectly
flat. Yeah, the liquid in the cups did not go anywhere.
Yeah.
They filmed this mostly in sequence, so as the actors' clothing got dirtier and more torn up, it was consistent between scenes, which is kind of brilliant, unless it took like weeks. Yeah. I've been wearing this same dirty shorts for 6 weeks. Can we stop now?
Yeah.
It was really good and still holds up well. The acting is excellent, even though most of the characters are types and stereotypes more than people, but it never really slows down or drags.
Yeah, this had a lot of action.
You've got the loudmouth cop. You've got the sexy hooker. You've got the old fat lady and the old Jewish man who just follows her around. You got the radical preacher and the little know-it-all kid and very bland and generic older sister. And
types, yeah.
Types,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, but it worked. They did it.
It worked. Yeah. It was good.
Yeah, it was entertaining.
I'm sure that there's more safety measures on these ships today than there was back then, but I think overall it kind of holds up.
Yeah,
if
I think so.
If you take the plot for what it is.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Then we watched a short film. What did we see?
Esther from 2023.
Directed by Matt Cunningham, written by him and also Brian Levin, stars Haley Heslip, 9 minutes, 56 seconds, and you can watch this on YouTube. There's a link in the show notes, as always. What happens?
Well, Katie has returned to her childhood home, and she's recording a message to her therapist. She's changed locations and jobs recently, and she's not doing so well. She's struggling. She's having especially trouble with one of the things she mentions, her smoke alarm going off every night at 2 a.m., even after she took out the batteries. She has an irrational fear of fire, so that's kind of important. She buys a new smoke detector, but that one goes off at 2 a.m. again.
There's no smoke.
No. She gets up to investigate and record something on her phone that she didn't expect.
Oh, my.
It's really good.
It's a one-actor show with Haley Heslip playing both Katie and Esther. She's good, and the story is excellent. The cinematography and music are great. The pacing is perfect, and the creature effects work well for the story.
Yeah, it did.
I don't know that it scared me, but watching this thing, the sound of the smoke alarm going off sent the cat under the bed for a couple of hours.
Yeah, we have two cats. One just sits there and doesn't care, and the other one, anytime she hears, well, any kind of sirens or alarms or anything like that, it's under the bed.
Yeah. For hours.
Yeah, a couple hours typically.
Yeah, so.
And she just heard it in, you know, beep, in this, you know, off of YouTube.
I know that sound.
Yeah, that sent her running.
All right, and if the sound of the smoke alarm does not scare you, then we've got the 1974's The Towering Inferno. Probably the peak of disaster movies. This was probably the height of the genre.
And a lack of smoke detectors.
Yeah, well, they explain that, though.
They do, yeah.
Directed by John Gillerman. Gillerman, we'll go with
we'll
that.
Go with Gillerman.
Written by Richard Martin Stern, Thomas N. Scotia, and Frank M. Robinson. It's actually a combination of two books.
The Tower Inferno.
And The Glass Inferno, mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, they merged them.
Which I have not read either of them. Have you?
I have not. No.
Stars Paul Newman, Steve McQueen, William Holden, Faye Dunaway.
And a whole bunch of other recognizable faces.
And a whole bunch, yeah. As we could say that with all of these. Yeah. Lots of recognizable faces.
Uh-huh.
2 hours, 45 minutes. So we're talking Lord of the Rings here. it's long.
And again, it's one of those posters where they have a lot of the famous faces on it.
You got Steve McQueen's face and Paul Newman's face. And I guess these two were really competitive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, supposedly still got along. But yeah, definitely competitive and a competition going on between them. Well, spoiler free.
What happens?
It's another long epic movie with a big cast of heavy hitters. It's also a classic and still holds up pretty well. And again, it's not strictly horror, but there's a big body count of trapped people who are victims of fire and falling.
So okay.
It's horrifying.
So there's a tower and an inferno.
Yes.
That's all you need to know, really.
big. Well, it's a fictitious
Is it the world's tallest building or just the city's?
It was, I think it was they were touting it as the tallest one in the world.
Okay.
It's much taller than...
It's a fictional building.
It's a fictional building.
160 yeah. floors. Well, we watch an impressive cast list on the screen as a helicopter flies over the countryside. It flies over the Golden Gate Bridge and eventually deposits architect Doug Roberts atop the tallest building in the city, which he helped design. It's actually the tallest building in the world.
Mm-hmm.
That answers that.
Yes.
Doug tells his boss, the building owner, Jim Duncan, that he's moving somewhere really boring and getting away from all this stress. Jim tells him that Senator Parker is coming to the big dedication ceremony tonight, and he plans to advocate for more of these giant buildings that Doug will design. Jim thinks Doug's quitting isn't serious.
You'll be back in a week.
And from what we hear between him and his wife, it's probably true, if this whole thing hadn't happened.
Mm-hmm.
Doug goes to his work office and deals with some problems with the building.
And what an office and what a private office.
Oh, these offices in this place are fantastic.
Yeah, they're huge. Well, it's a gigantic building, so they got all this space.
Well, he stops in his private office to meet his wife, Susan. He's got a bedroom in there, and he's not afraid to use it.
Yeah, it's like a full-fledged live-in apartment. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think it's meant to be his apartment. He lives with his wife somewhere else.
But, you know, yeah. Spend so much time at work, you know, if you want a little afternoon delight or whatever, you know.
Well, she complains that she doesn't really want to leave the city. She's just gotten a promotion at a job that means a lot to her, So we see that the two of them are in for a rocky situation.
Well, it's clear they're deeply in love and they get along really well and communicate really well, but this is going to be a clash.
Unlike airplane, where everybody, you know, gets a divorce at the end. Yeah. These two are getting along well.
Yeah, loving couple, definitely.
Harley Claiborne is a cheap old man who cheats the cabbie out of his tip. Mrs. Albright is a deaf woman with two children who do sign language with her. We don't get much of these people, but we see them. While working on the generators, some wiring burns out in the electrical room. We see somewhere else in the building, there's a storage room where the same kind of wiring has started a small fire in the utility room. Just bzz, bzz, out and set some rags on fire. Jernigan, the head of security, sees the sensor about the fire, but it doesn't show on their cameras. I forget, who's the actor playing Jernigan?
O.J. Simpson.
Back when he had a film career.
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't a huge role, but he did fine.
Yeah, he was kind of a hero.
Doug looks at the bad wiring in the electrical room. It should have been conduit, and it's not. Somebody messed up the wiring diagrams.
Somebody's been cutting corners.
He goes up to Jim's office and yells at him about the shoddy wiring in the building. Dan Bigelow, Jim's assistant, comes in, and they explain they almost had a fire. They haven't even finished installing all the safety equipment yet. The electrical construction guy, Simmons, can't be located.
Yeah, so this is a great
situation. There's no sprinklers. Yeah. There's no. I don't know if they even had fire detectors in 1974. Smoke detectors.
I don't know, but they don't have them anyway.
They certainly had sprinklers.
Yeah.
These guys don't.
So they're pushing it. They're having this grand opening of the building, and it's not ready yet.
These offices are in use.
Yes.
And
people are
living in the building.
Yeah, but not fully functional.
How do you get people living in a building that doesn't have sprinklers?
How do you get people living in there? Yeah. Yeah.
Well, it doesn't go well.
It doesn't. Yeah.
Well, Doug goes over to Roger Simmonson's house, and Doug accuses him of screwing around with the electrical specifications. Simmons thinks it's none of Doug's business. He swears everything is up to code, but Doug says that's not good enough. I see a problem here.
Mm-hmm.
It is all legal and up to code.
They just meant the minimum.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I mean, the minimums are there for a reason, aren't they?
Okay, they had primitive smoke detectors in the 1890s.
Yeah, well, it's not the one we have today.
The first heat and smoke detector, the first practical commercial patent and model was 1902.
I don't think we had them in our house in the 70s. I don't think they were something that just people bought.
They weren't a thing. Yeah, they weren't mass-produced and pushed, you know, the modern versions, but they had them. So a building this size and complex could have had them.
Well, Roger is married to Jim's daughter, so it is a family problem, and everyone knows Roger was getting kickbacks on the wiring. Harley knocks on Lysolette's door. They have a date to the big party tonight, and we also see that he has a suitcase full of fake stock certificates for something.
Let me just chime in with further information. The first home models, like we know them today, were 1965. That's when they started. It was not widely used until the 1970s when they started marketing them and pushing
after
them.
After this movie probably had a lot to do with it.
Oh, it could have. Yeah, it could have influenced it.
This was a very influential movie.
Uh-huh.
Well, many celebrities and politicians are arriving for the building's dedication ceremony tonight. The senator has a few words, and the mayor also shows up. They cut the ribbon and turns on all the lights in the building at once. Meanwhile, in the utility closet, the fire continues burning.
As the wiring heats up even more.
Dan goes to his office to make out with his secretary, Lori. He turns the phone off so he won't be disturbed. Fatal error.
Mm-hmm.
Harley feeds Lysolette a line of bull about destiny and how he just got home from the south of France. He's a poor man trying to pass him off as rich to impress her. There's some kind of scam going on here.
Mm-hmm.
Doug continues inspecting the wiring, but it's all too hot. He orders that some of the lights be turned off. He didn't realize that all the lights in the building were going to be turned on all at once for this show.
Yeah, the exterior of the building has just huge amounts of lights, and they've really cranked it up.
Jernigan calls the fire department about the sensor and goes down to the 81st floor to check on what's going on. Yeah, I like how they go down to the 81st floor.
Yeah, isn't that something?
Doug and his assistant get there first, and the assistant gets burned to death when he opens the utility room door. See, all the fire is in this one little closet. I don't see how.
Well, to start with.
Yeah, but then they get the fire hoses in there, and it's still in that closet. That fire should have been easier than that to put out.
It had spread through the interior structure of the building by then. It had started spreading. It wasn't just coming out the door there.
You say that as a logical answer, but the way that it's shown, it's just in that closet. They can't get the fire out in that closet. Like somebody had filled up gasoline or something. Well, Doug calls Jim about the fire below them, and he thinks the fire is under control, but if the wiring caused it, there could be fires everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Downstairs, the fire department arrives, and it looks like they brought all the trucks. Chief O'Halloran arrives and talks to Doug, who acknowledges that the sprinklers aren't even working yet. O'Halloran warns that they can't fight a fire that's over the seventh floor, but Doug says it's not his fault. O'Halloran is surprised that the 300 partygoers refused to evacuate. O'Halloran goes to the promenade room to get those people out of there, but Jim doesn't want to cooperate. Jim yells at Roger, who admits he changed the wiring diagrams to save costs. Jim tells the guests about the fire 50 floors below them and says they need to move the party downstairs to the lobby.
Yeah, at first, you know, they present it, you know, as a small fire, it's under control, but, you know, man, let's just move the party as a precaution, and everything's calm at this point.
Yeah.
Until
something explodes.
Yeah.
And the fireball is super obvious even outside the building. O'Halloran tells Doug to tell Jim to get everyone not to use the elevators. Use the scenic elevator outside. Don't overload it. It's like this glass elevator that goes up and down the outside of the building and holds 12 people.
Mm-hmm.
Roger accuses Jim of cutting all kinds of corners to shave money on the budget. It wasn't just him. Jim tells people not to use the main elevator, but they all pile in anyway. That goes badly for them.
Mm-hmm.
Lysolette runs to tell the deaf woman about the fire, since she probably didn't know about the evacuation orders. The elevator then returns to the promenade room, and burning people spill out. The party is over.
Yeah, the elevator glitched and stopped at the fire. And then came back.
Yay!
Yeah.
A lot of the people hadn't even really cared about the fire before. The party was still going on.
But now they care, yes.
Dan and his secretary, Lori, smell smoke. The lobby of their office is on fire. He tries to call for help, but he remembers he turned the phones off, so he pretends to go through them to keep Lori calm. He soon admits his lie. He puts on some wet towels and makes a run for help, but he doesn't get very far before burning to death. Lori breaks out a window and jumps. She's like on 100th floor or something.
Yeah, it goes poorly for both of them.
Jernigan hears about the deaf woman on 87 and goes down to evacuate them personally. Doug goes with him and they find the mother unconscious. The kid was wearing headphones and didn't hear anything. You think all that smoke in his room would have tipped him off?
You'd think so.
The fire has spread to several widely separated floors by this point. The partygoers are still evacuating, but the one safe elevator only holds 12 at a time. They find that one stairwell is full of smoke, and the other is blocked shut. Doug, Lysolette, and the two kids head down the one usable stairway, but a gas explosion wipes out the metal stairs. Doug carries the kids down, but Lysolette has to do it on her own. It's all very tense, but they make it. They find an elevator that can only go up since the fire is below them. In the electrical room, the generator burns out. This causes everything to get even more difficult.
Emergency lighting only.
How do they have emergency lighting and not sprinklers?
Well, they at least prepared that much, yeah.
Because the plot requires it.
The plot requires it, yeah. They put those in, but not the sprinklers yet.
Doug, Lysolette, and the kids finally make it to the party room. With most of the characters in the same room now, we switch into character mode where everybody talks. Harley admits to Lysolette that he's a poor con man, but she already knows that for some reason. She doesn't care. She still likes him.
She's savvy. She figured it out.
You're trying to cheat me out of everything I have, but you're a cute old guy, so it's all right.
Yeah, it's all right.
Doug and Jim argue about building codes and safety systems. The mayor and his wife have family regrets. The partygoers have no way out, so the air patrol brings in a helicopter to airlift the partygoers, but that goes really badly, and the helicopter crashes and explodes. So now the roof is on fire, too.
Yeah, great. Great progress.
The firemen break out some of the windows and run a line to the neighboring building. They tie off the lines and get everything set to run a basket back and forth to the next door's building roof. They start wheeling people over one by one. Jim's daughter gets out safely this way, but it's really slow.
It is, yeah.
Doug gets the scenic elevator working again, but only for one trip of 12 people coasting down on gravity. Lysolette kisses Harley goodbye, as does the mayor's wife. Doug's wife, and the kids as they board the elevator. Partway down, there's an explosion, and Lysolette falls out of the damaged elevator that's dangling by a cable.
Ah! Yeah.
O'Halloran hooks himself to a winch on the helicopter to lower the helicopter, to lower the elevator to the ground. This also works. I believed everything up to this point.
Yeah, it was a bit of a push.
This is like a, you know, a police helicopter. This is not a huge anything.
And so there's the weight of
the elevator.
11 people, 11-ish, 12-ish people. 12,
including O'Halloran and the fireman outside.
Yeah, there's the fireman, too. Yeah, and Halloran's on there. Plus, this elevator cannot be light, this car. Yeah.
It lowers him to the ground.
Lowers him gently to the ground.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah, we believed everything up to that point.
Well, the deputy fire chief comes up with the idea of blowing up the water tanks two floors above the party room. The falling water should put out most of the fire. They volunteer O'Halloran to set the charges. Time is running out in the party room. They only have 15 minutes left. O'Halloran tells Doug the water tank plan. Some fire appears in the stairwell, and Roger and a bunch of guys jump on the basket all at once. Roger kicks the senator off, who falls to his death. Then the wire snaps, and Roger falls too.
Quite dramatically.
Justice is served. O'Halloran takes a copter up to the roof with a bag full of explosives, and Doug meets him there. O'Halloran shows him how to set up the explosives, and they get to work.
Lots of explosives.
Yeah. The bombs go off, the water tanks explode, and water runs everywhere. The water rushes into the party room, and some of the people get washed right out of the windows. Looks like most of the water just pours out the windows, but eventually all the fire burns out. You know, and it's 160 floors. The fire is mostly on the 80th floor. But somehow or another, all this water doesn't rush out through all those broken windows. It manages to put out the fire. It
trickles down inside the building.
Yeah. Bull, I says. Bull.
You didn't buy that either. No, I didn't. No.
O'Halloran, Doug, Harley, and a few others make it out. Harley goes looking for Lysolette and learns that she didn't make it. Jernigan catches up with him and gives him the dead woman's cat. I mean, he didn't even know she had a cat. I'm like, what the hell is this cat here for?
You have a cat now. Congratulations.
O'Halloran looks at the firemen in body bags, and he says they were lucky. The body count was less than 200.
Oof.
Well, it's better than having a fully populated building.
Yeah, it could have been worse.
These disaster movies had proven themselves to be really popular, so the casting choices just kept getting more and more big names. They were also getting longer and more epic. This one's nearly 3 hours long, which was nearly unheard of in the 70s. I don't know, you think this one had an intermission or something in the middle?
No, it might have. I doubt it.
Didn't when we watched it. Funny how the firemen were spraying tons and tons of water on the fire in the utility closet, and it didn't make any difference, even in the small rooms. Almost as if the fires were fake and gas-powered or something. Was this building 160 floors of wood and dynamite? There's so much fire everywhere with occasional explosions, but there's not nearly as much smoke as there should be. And again, we've already talked about the little helicopter and the elevator, and it just doesn't seem possible. Could the water in the tanks at the top floor make it very far with all those broken windows up high? No. There's a lot of stuff in this film that just isn't as bad as it should be. People, the flame, people don't get cooked as quickly as they should. The smoke is...
Smoke would have been worse, yeah. But it's a movie.
People run around all day and there's smoke everywhere, but nobody coughs. I don't remember hearing anybody coughing in this movie.
No, not much. No.
Still, this is one of those movies you watch for the cast, not because it's particularly realistic. In the end, the building is essentially uninhabitable, even without the wiring issues. How does one go about demolishing a building that tall?
Piece by piece.
One floor at a time.
Yeah. And because the internet has everything, looked it up. No, the Towering Inferno did not have an official intermission, but some theaters did. If they wanted to.
We're going to stop here, so y'all can go spend money on popcorn and pee.
Yeah, basically. Have an hour and a half and then another hour and a half, yeah. Officially, well, no. There wasn't.
The performances are good, the plot moves quickly, and the cast is unsurpassed. Actually, I think the previous two movies had better casts, but this one had a lot of people in it.
Oh, but Paul Newman and Robert Redford, and not Robert Redford, Paul Newman and Steve McQueen.
It's the same guy. It's the same guy.
They're not interchangeable, no. And I thought that was awesome having them in the same movie.
And now we're going to shake things up a bit with Earthquake from the same year as Towering Inferno. Actually, I read that... No, that's a different movie. Never mind. Earthquake, directed by...
One after the other.
Yeah, that not Towering Inferno. It was Earthquake and then...
Airport
75.
Airport 75,
within
yeah.
weeks of each other.
Yeah, one after the other. He didn't get a break. Charlton Heston went from right from one to the other.
Yeah. So anyway, Earthquake 74, directed by Mark Robson, written by George Fox and Mario Puzo, the Godfather writer, stars Charlton Heston, Ava Gardner, George Kennedy, Lauren Green, 2 hours and 2 minutes.
Once again, a massive cast.
Yep.
Yeah.
And trailer in the show notes. This one, actually, it's got the big word earthquake and buildings falling down. It's got the cast down at the bottom, but it's not quite the cast as the others. But Charlton Heston, he was big at the time.
Yeah, and this is another big epic disaster, the portrayal, not the movie itself, which was actually pretty good. And the horror, again, comes from the high body count and the fact that things like this can and do happen in the world.
I think this probably had the biggest body count.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a lot of the people in the city died.
Los Angeles, where this takes place, hasn't had one this bad.
But everybody thought they would at the time.
Yeah, well, and theoretically it could happen any time. But, you know, we've recently had the massive earthquake in Turkey and Syria, and, you know, big ones happen.
Yep. But I think, I don't know, in the 70s and 80s, everybody kept talking about the big one that's going to wipe out half of... I mean, look at the plot of Superman.
Mm-hmm.
The whole point was to wipe out California.
Yeah.
Is that still...
Well, that was silly. But...
Well, yeah, that was. But do people still talk about the big one hitting Los Angeles? We don't live anywhere near there, so I have no idea. But
it's just a matter of time. Yeah. Major fault lines and, yeah... And...
People, they say the same thing about Yellowstone, people, too, but I don't see anybody freaking out about that yet.
Yellowstone is less of a concern, and they can track Yellowstone better. They can predict Yellowstone, the super cauldron. They can track that better than predicting earthquakes.
Yeah, the sun's going to go supernova one of these days, too.
Well, yeah.
We're all going to die!
Yeah.
Well, anyway, as credits roll, we see flyover shots of Los Angeles, ending on a lingering shot of a big dam. We cut to Stuart Graff, who argues with his wife, Remy, which seems like a regular thing between these two. She overdoses while he's in the shower, and that's a regular thing too, apparently. It's happened before, so he knows the procedure. There's a small earthquake, and she freaks out. She was faking the whole thing.
Mm-hmm. And then he says, you know, next time you try that, you might want to flush the pills. You know, she had the empty bottle dramatically beside the bed. You know?
Yeah, he knew she was faking.
And, you know, she flushed. She put them in the toilet, didn't flush. So, yeah, he knew.
So many problematic marriages in these disaster movies.
Yeah, they've got one.
Well, we soon see that Graff works for Sam Royce, who is his father-in-law. The maintenance crew up at the dam feel a tremor and start doing a routine inspection. Max soon finds Fred drowned in the elevator shaft at the dam. Well, that ain't right.
That's not right.
Something's flooded down there. Meanwhile, Officer Lou Slade and his police car chase down a bad guy. Stuart stops off at Denise's house, and we see that she's an actress wannabe. She's Stuart's friend's widow and mother to Corey. And we were trying to figure out, is she his sister, girlfriend? And
they're just
turns out,
very good friends.
Yeah. His friend's widow.
Uh-huh.
And maybe a little more. We'll find out later.
Yep.
Over at the Seismological Institute, Walter Russell hears about the elevator shaft thing, and he whines that the boss is out of town and he thinks there's going to be a big earthquake today.
Or soon, very soon.
The boss, Dr. Adams, is working out in the field and can't check his computations. Dr. Adams, meanwhile, is working inside a big crack in the ground, a fault line. Another tremor happens, and he and his assistant are buried alive. Whoa.
The body count already begins.
Two. It's going to be more than two before we're done.
Way more than two.
Motorcycle daredevil Miles gets ready for his act and begs for some money from Lou. Miles wants Rosa to be his groupie for the show. It's not a group. Roadie?
Roadie,
yes.
Roadie, not groupie. Well,
kind of the same thing.
Yeah.
He describes his show to her, and we see loops, jumps, and flaming rings. He claims to be way better than Evel Knievel. Remember when that was a thing?
He's got a pretty cool setup.
He does a practice run, and that goes badly on the first try, but he gets it the next time. Meanwhile, the men at the dam find some anomalies. The seismologists realize that Dr. Adams is dead, and Walter Russell may be right, but if they say anything, there'll be mass panic.
Yeah, they can't be sure that he's right. And, you know, what are you going to do? You know, you can't evacuate a city the size of Los Angeles, and it'll just cause panic. And so they say, yeah, let's just not announce it.
They decide to call the mayor, who activates the National Guard, but doesn't make the predicted quake public. We see Jody as a grocery store manager, who gets called for National Guard duty. We learn that Stuart and Denise are a bit more than friends. Stuart talks to clients about buildings, paying extra for earthquake safety features. It's a new thing. We build our buildings earthquake-proof.
Totally worth it.
Sam, Stuart's boss and father-in-law, asks about Denise, and he clearly suspects Stuart is cheating on his daughter, Remy. Remy knows, too, and arranged for her father to give Stuart a promotion if he'll stay away from Denise. Give you a promotion if you quit cheating on me.
Uh-huh.
Remy and Stuart argue. Well, the big earthquake hits. Miles' show is destroyed. Rose is in a theater that collapses.
And I remember, too, this being a big thing. I saw this in the theater when it came out. They upgraded the sound system in a lot of the theaters, and you could feel the rumble and feel the earthquake. It was really impressive, the sound system. And
apparently there was a lot of trouble with that. People getting sick and everything else. It was so loud.
Mm-hmm.
Bridges collapse, power lines break, and towers collapse. A house on a hill almost rolls over Denise. Stuart and Remy try not to get crushed in their office building as people fight over the elevators. Some people learn not to take the elevator in an earthquake. If we've learned anything from these movies,
stay away from elevators.
Take the stairs.
You gotta take the stairs when you can.
There are an excessive number of scenes of destruction as we see characters dealing with the quake. The city is left a burning, crumbling disaster. Inside the tower, Sam Royce tries to calm everyone down, but that's going to be a tough job. The people can't get out because the stairway has collapsed. He comes up with an idea to lower an office chair tied to a fire hose to lower people down to where Stuart is. And that office chair looked like it was 200 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
He lowers dozens of people down safely. Then when he's alone, he has a heart attack. The doctor doesn't tell anybody that he dies to avoid a panic. Though the guys at the dam argue about something being broken in the relief valves, it won't budge. They eventually get the floodgates open, which floods the LA River, which is where Denise is searching for Corey. She finds him lying unconscious next to some high-voltage power lines as the floodwaters approach.
And at this point, they're not really flood lines. It's flood waters. It's controlled, you know, those cement troughs. You know,
yeah, there's no real flood
where they
here.
Have channeled rivers. It's just dry, and periodically they let off relief or whatever. So it's not really a disaster flood at this point.
I have heard that in real life that the most of that L.A. River has not seen water in decades.
Yeah, yeah. Those,
too much
those
drought.
Channels are just perpetually dry, yeah.
But they use them for this.
Yep.
Well, they pulled Denise and Corey out just before they're electrocuted. Officer Lou barks that many of the police were killed when the police station collapsed, and he starts yelling orders to the civilians, who are mostly panicking. Jody and the National Guard show up and start helping people. When Stuart goes off to find Denise, he and Remy argue some more, because now's the time for that. Rosa gets arrested for stealing a donut, and Jody recognizes her. He gets her released, but not because he's a good guy. Cody catches his annoying roommates looting and shooting them all. They were picking on him before for selling out to the man and being part of the National Guard.
Revenge.
Yeah. Well, they're not going to do that again.
No, they're not.
Once the other soldiers are gone, he brings Rosa food and tries to undress her, which she doesn't appreciate.
No. No, she does not.
Officer Lou flags down Stuart's car and uses it as an ambulance, so most of the characters wind up at the parking garage that's being used for an emergency hospital. There's another quake, and lots of people at the hospital die. Jody's company decides he's crazy and abandons him as Lou and Stuart hear Rosa screaming. Lou ends up shooting Jody. This time, the experts find that the dam has actually started to leak.
Yeah, it's the earthquake hits and all this stuff just keeps happening afterwards.
Yeah, the flood relief isn't going fast enough.
Nope.
Stuart hears that Sam Royce and Remy are trapped beneath the hospital in the sub-basements, which will flood if the dam breaks. See, she's there looking for her father, who we know died like an hour ago, but nobody told anybody.
She doesn't know that.
He and Lou go down into the sewers to try to save people down there. Meanwhile, the dam totally breaks apart, spilling zillions of gallons of water down the mountain toward the city. One damn thing after another.
It is.
Stuart breaks through the wall, letting Denise, Corey, and 70 other people out. We get more shots of violent flooding going on all over town. Stuart and Lou finally get everyone else out of the parking garage and work their way out of the tunnels. There's a bit of a backup as people climb out of the sewers on a ladder, and soon they hear water rushing toward them.
Uh-oh.
The water floods the sewers and washes a bunch of people away, including Remy. Stuart jumps back in to save her, and they both drown. Oh, bummer.
Yeah.
Lou looks for them, but they're gone.
And I understand that was Charlton Heston's request for that ending.
Yes, they were written so that Lou would die.
Uh-huh, and he would make it out, and no, he wanted... You know, he thought that was the moral thing for his character to do.
He was having an affair, so he wanted the character to die.
To redeem himself, and yeah.
Well, there's a lot of mayhem and goings-on during the actual earthquake scenes. Just when things start to calm down, there's another aftershock, and then there's a flood. This might be the most disastery of the films we've looked at this week.
And the highest body count, for
sure. Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
Actually, I think Meteor from the bonus newsletter probably has the highest body count.
Yeah. Yeah,
they wiped out all of Hong Kong, a big chunk of New York, and a bunch of other places.
Yes, yeah.
Charlton Heston, as Stuart, was originally supposed to have survived the flooding and be with Denise, but he thought that was immoral and insisted they change the script to kill him. Originally, Officer Lou, who I thought was pretty unsympathetic, he was just a loudmouth yelling.
He was good at his job, but he was kind of a jerk about it.
He wasn't good at his job. He was fired in the beginning. Well, okay. He wasn't really even a cop anymore.
Okay.
Yeah, he was not a particularly good guy. He was supposed to die, but they switched it around so Lou lived and Stuart died. The acting is fine, and some of the situations are a little contrived, such as the Stuart, Remy, Sam, Denise, all being interconnected and important players in the story. Officer Lou seems like a real jerk, so they had to give him a little dog to save.
Yeah, there is that. Yeah.
At the end, he saves the dog.
Uh-huh.
Lauren Green gets to die heroically, something he never got to do in Bonanza, but probably wanted to after 14 years of playing the same boring character on that show. Yeah, wow.
He was awfully one note in Bonanza.
Well, I think it was written that way.
Most of the show was one note.
Absolutely. And speaking of one note, that's our show for this week.
It is.
Tune in next week. We'll have four more movies and a short, and we will have some smaller scale disasters for you.
Mm-hmm.
People versus nature. Nature wins.
Nature does.
And be sure to stop over at horrorguys.com to read all the reviews. Stop over at horrorbulletin.com to get those free bonus reviews in our newsletter. And go to horrorguysshop.com to pick up your free copy of the Halloween book using promo code Halloween.
Halloween.
Until next week. I'm Brian.
I'm Kevin.
We'll see you when?
Next week.
See ya.
See ya.